Okay, setting a proper motivation, which consists of three parts: refuge field, bodhicitta field, and the purposeless practice. For the refuge field, visualize Guru Shakyamuni, His Holiness the Dalai Lama, and all the enlightened beings who are the sources of inspiration for you, pertaining to regenerating unconditional love of bodhicitta and the wisdom of emptiness. And go to the field. Visualize your two parents around you and all your family members, including children and all sentient beings here in Bangalore. And this purposeless practice is to awaken the seed of perfection, the Buddha niche within us, into the state of fearlessness and into the state of infinite happiness. For that matter, we need to know the nature of the matter of elements, to obscure this Buddha nature. The wood when mixed with the soil,
volume has increased, we can hear properly.
This is good.
From the front, I can't hear much.
Speakers are
here. You want to send this speaker?
Yes, possible.
Mixed with soil, the gold is not visible, the gold doesn't glow. It doesn't mean that the gold is not there, it's simply because of the presence of the soil, that the glow of the gold is obstructed. As you remove the soil, the gold inside automatically glows. Likewise, although the seed of perfection is within us, the seed of fearlessness, and the seed of infinite happiness is within us, with the presence of the mental defilements, like the soil, the gold of the seed of perfection within us doesn't grow. So our job is to get rid of the mental defilements, get rid of the soil. And for that matter, we need to identify what these mental defilements are. And the mental defilements are of two kinds, the gross and the subtle. The gross one, like the solid garlic, the presence of this, the gross mental defilements, stops us from achieving our fearlessness. And the subtle one is like the smell of the garlic. When you remove the garlic, salt garlic, but still in the mug, the smell, it still smells garlic. So that smell is the very subtle mental defilements, referred to as the cognitive obscurations. The presence of this blocks us from achieving infinite happiness. In both cases, the remedy remains the wisdom of emptiness, for the reason that the gross one, which is referred to as afflictive obscurations, is of three kinds: contaminant karmas, afflictions, and the active seeds. And all these three somehow hover around self-grasping ignorance. And given that ignorance can best be eradicated by the wisdom, likewise, it is only the wisdom of emptiness which can get rid of the afflictive obscurations, driven by the force of renunciation. And the subtle mental obscurations, subtle spell, also referred to as cognitive obscurations, the presence of this stops us from achieving Buddhahood or infinite happiness. And the remedy remains the same, the wisdom of emptiness, but the driving force must be extremely powerful one, that is the Bodhicitta. So it is for this reason that we need these three parts. One is the wisdom of emptiness, which is the liberating part, supported by the wisdom of emptiness, supported by Bodhicitta. And then this Bodhicitta must be grounded on the renunciation. So these three are referred to as the three principal parts: renunciation, Bodhicitta, and the wisdom of emptiness. Okay, so our job here, yesterday and today, is to activate this Buddha nature within us, to activate these three principal parts. With that, mind, let's turn to page 3, and you are leading this, and imagine that all sentient beings are joining you in this journey of cleansing the mind to discover your true nature. Page 3. And this is my great compassion. We taught the Mahayana Dharma to restore all the worldly views. To you, the Buddha Gautama, I pay homage. And this is my great compassion. You taught the Mahayana Dharma to restore all the worldly views. To you, the Buddha Gautama, I pay homage. And this is my great compassion. You taught the Mahayana Dharma to restore all the worldly views. To you, the Buddha Gautama, I pay homage. Sanye chöda tsoke chonam la chanjo padu dani gyatsu che dage jin so kebe tsonam roda penjere sanye rupara isho sanye chöda tsoke chonam la chanjo padu dani gyatsu che dage jin so kebe tsonam Dora penjere sangye dhubara isho Sangye chodam sogye chonam Tanju bardo dhani gyatsu che Gage jin sogye be chonam Dora penjere sangye dhubara isho I go for a future turning enlightened to the Buddha, the Dhamma, the Sangha by my accumulations and practice of giving and so forth may I become a Buddha to benefit all sentient beings. I go for refuge and turn enlightened to the Buddha, the Dhamma, and the Sangha. By my accumulations of practice of giving and so forth, may I become a Buddha to benefit all sentient beings. I go for refuge and turn enlightened to the Buddha, the Dhamma, and the Sangha. By my accumulations of practice of giving and so forth, may I become a Buddha to benefit all sentient beings. Independent origination, there is no ceasing, no rising, no annihilation, no permanence, no coming. Sadness, and I prostrate to the consummate Buddha, the supreme among all teachers, the one who taught this peace, which is free of vibrations. I prostrate to the mothers of the hearers, the bodhisattvas, and the Buddhas, who through the knowledge of all these here seek manifestation complete peace, who through the knowledge of past causes those have been migrated to the chief aims in the world, and who through the possession of nations have subdued various economic variety of teachings, the one who is transformed into the reliable guide, motivated by others to benefit sentient beings. The teacher is Sukhana, protector to your administrations. The one who has eliminated the web of conceptualizations and is endowed with the divine qualities of the vast and profound. Who attained ambition for the forever noble life race, to you the Buddha administrations. Inspired by wisdom and compassion, today the Buddha's lessons are taking the mind full of awakening for the benefit of all sentient beings.
Shankatha Gato Yavatat samshayo nirodha evam vade maha shramanaya swaha om ye dharma hetu prabhava hetum kesham tathagato yavatat esham chayo
profound, peaceful, elaboration, free, clear, light, non-composite, such as nature like Dharma undiscovered. Find no one who can fathom this teaching in silence or eternity. Your natural thought and expression is the perfection of wisdom, which sounds for enhanced season as the nature of space. It is what you have, and it is from the first year of our wisdom. You, the mother of Buddhas, for three times, have made reasons. All composite things are permanent. All contaminated things of nature are suffering. All phenomena of the nature and fitness subsistence, concerning sorrow and speed. The Guru is the Buddha, the Guru is the Dharma, likewise the Guru is the Sangha. The Guru is the source of all peoples. I go for refuge in the Guru. By the sound of the vital enjoyment of Dharma, you will liberate all beings of miseries. I beseech you to continue remaining in teachings until the end of the expansive beings of chaos. The Buddha does not wash the negative of beings, nor does he remove their misery by his hands. His spiritual realization does not happen. He is achieving the truth of suchness that beings are liberated. With folded hands, I beseech the Buddhas of all directions to chant Father Dharma for all the different miseries of the world. If you are attached to this life, you are not a spiritual practitioner. If you are attached to samsara, you are more than renunciation. If you are attached to your own self-interest, you are more than bodhicitta. If it is grasping, you do not have to view. Which page 31? Our Sutra Mantra. As we recite this mantra, let us be reminded of the Bodhicaryavatara exhorting us thus. Don't remain in the fears of samsara. Come to us our ultimate happiness. May you hear this melodious voice of Bodhicaryavatara. We inspire you to parents, we inspire all your family members, including children. We inspire everyone in Bangalore, in India, in the world, in the Milky Way galaxy, and in the entire universe. All such beings, human beings, animals, insects, the spirits, god and goddesses, hungry ghosts, hell beings, everyone. And they hear what you are saying. You are so happy to see. And they are so happy to see that this is the hope. We all have this good energy inside us. We all have the single profession within us. Our job is simply to follow the correct path. And you lead them in this path of the wisdom of emptiness, bodhicitta, and the renunciation, three principal paths. And everybody so happily joins you in this journey of cleansing the mind, we discover this treasure of the Buddha nature within each one of us. Open the mind as we start to mantra 7 times.
Gati, Gati, Paragati,
Okay, continuation from where we left yesterday. What we were talking about was that the mantra which we set from dependent origination, the sutra, the Noble Mind Sutra on dependent origination. From India, it was on page 61. And the other version is, which page was that? Other version, there are two books.
57.
We came to the point of Ye Dharma, the mantra, Ye Dharma Hetu Prabhava, Hetu Mutation Dadagato, Hiyalaka, Tesham Jayu Niruta, Evam Vadi Mahashamanai Soha. So, the idea is that the Arvaruk, the Shariputra, he asks this question to the Buddha. No, sorry, Arvarukteshvara. The asks this question to the Buddha as to how all these the gods and goddesses, they are here. And the Buddha, of course, is in the god realm, presiding over the congregation of the bodhisattvas and all the great bodhisattvas and the god and goddesses. And the Buddha was seated on King Indra's throne. And Arya Nagarjuna, he stood up and raised this question to Buddha. In other words, not really question, it's more, he made the request, saying that all these god and goddesses, they came here to learn as to how to accumulate enormous amount of merit, which is also known as the merit of the Brahma. Merit of Brahma meaning the merit, enormous merit, the merit enough, good enough for one to take birth as the Brahma. Brahma is one of the kings of the celestial beings, the god and goddesses. So that requires a tremendous merit. So how can one accumulate such a merit? This is what all these god and goddesses, they want to learn. And the Buddha then said this mantra, Ye dharma hetu prabhava hetum desham tadakato hiyavata desham jayu nirut evam vati mahashamane soha. Look at next page. The middle of the mantra which we did yesterday, all phenomena arise from causes. All phenomena meaning that all composite phenomena, the phenomena of happiness, the phenomena of suffering that we go through, the happiness that we see, they don't arise randomly. And the suffering which we experience, they also don't arise randomly. They all arise from the spirit of causes. From this, the message that we need to take and take away is that we seek happiness and we always go for a shortcut. Happiness, we want a shortcut. We don't want to put effort. This is where we're going wrong. We're going for a shortcut to get the happiness, and this is extremely risky to go for the, for example, some going to the corruption, going to alcoholism. These are all the shortcuts, and shortcuts are not really good ideas. Because these happiness, they don't arise from the alcohol, not from the corrupted money. Instead, they arise from the respective causes. There are proper causes here, cause conditions here. And even the suffering also, they arise from the respective cause conditions. With this, the message that we take from this mantra is to always be reminded, not only you, me, including me also, including me, we should be reminded that, okay, any bad thing that I do will have a negative consequence. And any good thing that I do, they will not go in waste. There is the benefit there. This is something which will ripe into happiness. This is what we always have to keep in mind. And instead of going for the shortcuts, we have to go for reliable measures to acquire happiness and to get rid of the suffering. Okay, for this, all phenomena arise from causes. The causes are taught by the Tathagata, not precisely the suffering, but we said yesterday, was that nobody wants suffering. That's a fact. And if we, anybody volunteer allowed to listen to you, you know, some of the say very painful experiences. Can you share with me? Would like to share with us here? Yes, Jack.
When I have two children, Stephanie is now 29. But when she was a year and a half, she had an older brother, Michael, who was almost 4. And we were celebrating at a family reunion. And my ex-wife's cousin was celebrating, it was a 4th of July celebration, which is an American celebration with fireworks, etc. The last product of the night was defective and shot across the ground and struck my son in the back of his head, and he died the next morning.
So they again, look, this is the pain, enormous pain. So these are the kind of the pains that, you know, we go through, and that it is not just, you know, in Jack. Anybody, any place, any time, these problems can happen. Okay, so these problems, they're respective causes. Respective causes. So for that matter, the one thing that we need to keep in mind is what kind of problems, what kind of disasters can befall on us? We're not too sure. And yet, alongside these problems, there is the pain associated. Particularly for the parents and their children, the pain, the love and affection is so profound that the pain, corresponding pain, is acutely painful. So how do we deal with these pains? So it says that all phenomena arise from causes. The causes are taught by the Tathagata. So these the problems have their causes, respective causes. We have to identify what these causes are. Okay, when we go through this problem, of course, people who are exposed to these studies, like the sutra and the three principal paths, who is exposed to these deeper studies, we should be, when we encounter, when we meet with other people who go through these emotional crises, there we should be really skillful. Don't just say that it is your the wrapping of the negative karma. We are not to say like this. We should be extremely skillful. Because instead of helping, it may harm that person. We should be the first thing that we need to do is that we have to consult the person instead of saying that it's your negative karma. This one thing. And then let the person be exposed to the deeper reality, so that the person will be in a position to tackle the situation effectively and realize what the real problem is. Okay, so what we learn is all phenomena arise from causes. The causes are taught by the Tathagata. The sensation of causes is where the struggle that grace here. What are the causes of all these sufferings is taught by the Tathagata, is taught by the Buddha. And once you know the causes of the suffering, what the causes of suffering are, and you know how to get rid of these causes by applying the remedies, then our job is to apply the remedies and the causes will come to an end. Yesterday what we learned was if there is the poisonous tree growing there and the wind blowing through the tree, the leaves, poison leaves, skin rashes on your body. So you just uproot the tree, find the leaves, the stems, and the root. Unless you uproot it, just chop from the top at the most, can give you a respite, a short respite, but not give you lasting the peace. For lasting peace, we have to uproot this. So for that matter, we have to know all these, how the mechanism, how the suffering comes to being. We have to learn that. This is so important. And this stanza is so important. This actually the mantra, Yedarmain, this mantra. If you can recite this mantra on a daily basis, and then on this basis, see how to be more reflective. Reflect on the fact of how the misery is coming to being. And of course, for example, in the case of the Jack's thing, so the child, there's a tremendous pain there, and yourself, tremendous pain there, out of love and affection. And so, the point is, how to get rid of these pains. How to get rid of these pains in the long run. Okay, so for that matter, we need to know how these pains arise, the mechanism. If we don't know how the pains arise, then our treatment, all our the remedies that we try to apply, they become like, you know, so you have a headache, you give just paracetamol. You have a stomachache, then you give paracetamol. This is just symptomatic treatment. This is not the treatment from the root. We have to go for both. Symptomatic immediate treatment, immediate measure, as well as long-term measure. We have to plan, we have to have a plan for both, which is so important. Okay, so in this respect, yesterday, the first only shared with you that the Bangalore people, you are very fortunate. You are very fortunate that you have a center here at the Choe Center. You are extremely fortunate. And I'm again reiterating this, that for example, like the teachers who are coming here, Venerable Ratana here, and the Venerable Gishnandala coming, then all the teachers coming here, you are very fortunate. And then Bangalore is a place where human teachers, they, you know, they pass by through this Bangalore. So you have the opportunity to meet with those teachers and receive teachings. And for that matter, particularly what I would say is that the people who are taking charge, responsibility of this center, for example, the trustees, they are extremely, extremely kind that anybody in Bangalore, this place is open. Okay, only if you are like this is with this label, then you can enter this hall. Otherwise, you're not. No, such a rule is not there. Anybody is welcome, which means that there's a center there. It's not easy to run a center. It's so difficult, so much challenges. And the, for example, the Shandila and everybody, all in the trustee, they always has a sense of, you know, responsibility to make sure that it runs smoothly. There's an extra burden in the mind. So of course, for them, this is an incredibly great gesture of kindness and great service to the Dharma, acknowledge merit, and others, we all should be feeling very grateful to all these trustees, including the director, Shandila. This is something that we need to really think of. Okay, with this in mind, now the point is that I'm so impressed by Venerable Ratana over interacting. Okay, so of course, we know each other for so many years. And particularly Shogasuning, his feeling of, you know, a sense of responsibility to take care of each and every individual with so much love, exuding love and affection, concern. This is exemplary. So we're very lucky. In fact, I always tell people that for example, when I travel to Malaysia, Singapore, Vietnam, then Italy, France, Israel, when I travel there and when I come to know that some people, they have a personal relationship with their teachers, I said, you are very fortunate to have such a, you know, wonderful teacher who really gives you guidance. There's so much of sense of concern, care and so forth. So likewise, I can see the Venerable Dalai Lama over these many years, I could see more and more, I can see that he really feels that this center must be uplifted, must be supported. Okay, so the whole purpose for this center is for us to learn something. How to learn? What to learn? Learn how to minimize your suffering, how to maximize your happiness. So that is on the basis of what we learned yesterday. External factors, how to identify external factors, identify the internal factors. And we should be very realistic. And anything that I emphasized so much yesterday was that come to show something. And the first thing that we should learn is that we should be very realistic. Learn how to be realistic. External factors are there, internal factors are there for your sufferings. So, how to curb the external factors to the best you can, and how to curb internal factors to the best you can. To curb the external factors, that is relatively easier. But to curb the internal factors, we need to first of all identify what the internal factors are. Then apply the remedies. So for that, it involves extensive learning, reflection, and meditation. Okay, so with this in mind, it says that the causes are taught by the Tathagata. What are the causes of the suffering? They are taught by the Tathagata, they are taught by the Buddha. Okay, this is where I'd like to share with you here. And so for this, I'd like to give the analogy of a dream. Of a dream. Let's say that you're dreaming. You're in your you're fast asleep and you start dreaming. And in the dream, you dream of attending a class in Chogosumi. And then the person who was speaking to you raises something up. And then you see this as a mobile. Okay, tell me what is this?
Battery.
Huh?
Battery, microphone.
It's a microphone.
Microphone or a dream microphone?
Real microphone.
I said that you are dreaming.
Dream.
Be a good listener. I said you were dreaming. In your dream, you are dreaming of attending class in Choe Sumlin, CTSL. In the dream, the person who is talking to you lifts this up. What is this?
Dream microphone.
You're getting a drone, say microphone. Dream microphone. I lift this up, and then you see this as a mobile. Right? This is a mobile. Okay, is this a valid point? Seeing the dream, seeing a dream, the microphone as a mobile. Is it a valid mind or ignorance?
Ignorance?
It is ignorance. Okay, look. How the Buddha said that all problems are rooted to ignorance. So let's see how from this ignorance all the problems start. Then you see this as, oh, this mobile there. What mobile? That is Samsung mobile or Lenovo mobile or iPhone X. You looked at it, you see this iPhone X. Wow, iPhone X. Okay. Then you think that, okay, Bishala does not really want iPhone X. I can give, you know, mine a 3,000 rupees mobile. I can exchange it. Right? Okay, then you say that, oh, Bishala, would you mind exchanging our mobiles? Then the other person sees me and says, no, I said it first. So two of you will have a fist fight. Right? Fist fight. And as a result of this fight, what happens? Both of you end up in prison. And prison is not a nice place. This is extremely important point. This is extremely important point that I'm making. Let me review this once more. First, I pick up this dream microphone. And you see this as?
Mobile,
number one. This is ignorance. Then you look at it very closely and you think, oh, it's not only mobile, it's iPhone X. Then what happens? Then the attachment comes to the mobile. And then you ask for exchange. And the other person said, no, I said it. Then your anger arose against your competitor. So the first, see the dream microphone as mobile, number one. Then number two is see that mobile as mobile iPhone X, number two. Then you feel attached to this and aversion to your competitor, number three. Then what happens? Then you fist fight, number four. Then number five, both of you end up in prison. Okay. Then your mother comes. Right? Mother comes to the prison. You went to Choe Sumling for Dharma and found you ended up in prison. Why? What did you do? You're a very kind girl otherwise. You're a very kind boy. Why did you end up in prison? Then what is your response? Tell me. Prison is not a nice place. Why did you end up in prison? Why? Huh? No, first immediate cause. No, with the ignorance, everybody has the ignorance. Everybody doesn't go to prison, right? What is the unique cause to be in prison? Fist fight. You get a fist fight. Okay, fist fight. Okay. Prison is samsara. This is because of the fist fight, which is karma. Contaminated karma. Contaminated karma. And why contaminated karma? Why did you fight? What made you to fight? Attachment to the mobile and aversion to the competitor. Right? Okay. aversion to the competitor and attachment to the mobile. This is the affliction. Why do you have the affliction? Why do you have this attachment to mobile? Because it's not just mobile, it's iPhone X. You exaggerate the quality of the mobile. You exaggerate the quality of the object. You exaggerate the characteristic of the object, number three. And what, how come that this iPhone, what made you see that this iPhone 6, iPhone X, this is not at all iPhone, this is not at all mobile in the first place. It's just a dream microphone. You getting it? You exaggerate the dream microphone as a real mobile. This is ignorance, number one. This is the trigger point of all the succeeding the problems. Then this ignorance makes you, first one is the exaggeration of the object. Object. Number two is the exaggeration of the characteristic of the object. Then number three is the attachment, aversion, affliction. That is affliction. Then actions, contaminated karmas, then miseries. Okay, 5 points, keep in mind. What's number one? Ignorance which misperceives the object. Number one. Ignorance which misperceives the object. Number two. Ignorance which misperceives the characteristic of the object. Number two. Number three. Afflictions. Affliction meaning attachment, anger, jealousy, all these things. Then number four. Contaminated karmas, number four. Get it down? Okay, contaminated karmas. Then finally, miseries or samsara. Okay, this is how our miseries come to being. So therefore, let's say, even all miseries, somehow they're triggered through these five processes. This is the meaning of the causes are taught by the Tathagata. The causes of the suffering, what causes of suffering are, is taught by the Tathagata. What causes? Contaminated karmas. What causes? Contaminated. Immediate cause of suffering is contaminated karmas. Afflictions. Inappropriate attention. Okay. Misperceiving the characteristics of the object.
Misperceiving the object, then misperceiving the characteristics of the object.
No. Be good listener. I think you said, I don't know whether this is Chogosuma problem or Benma problem. Here, there's a little problem there. So we are going from top down. Sometimes we can go from down top. Sometimes we go from top down. We start. At the moment, you're going from the suffering. I said, what's the immediate cause of suffering? Contaminated karma. What's the immediate cause of contaminated karma? Afflictions. What is the immediate cause of the afflictions? Okay, misperception of the characteristics of the object. This is technically known as inappropriate attention. Misperception of the characteristics of the object is referred to as the inappropriate attention. This is a technical term. Inappropriate attention. Then, this inappropriate attention or the misperception of the characteristic of the object is because of the misperception of the object. That is the self-grasping ignorance. Self-grasping ignorance. Okay, so we see these, if you know these five so well, and in fact, whenever you attend the teachings of His Holiness the Dalai Lama, he will ground his teaching, oftentimes, he will ground his teaching on the basis of these 5 points, which were so beautifully explained by Arya Nagarjuna, indicated by Arya Nagarjuna in his text, Fundamental Wisdom of the Middle Way. Okay, chapter 18, page 115. Page 116. Okay, most of you have it on page 116. Others maybe before that. That is chapter. Okay, some of you have know what I'm saying is chapter 18. Chapter 18, stanza 5. Okay, chapter 18, stanza 5. Most of you have on page 116.
Or 116.
Okay, how many you or? 111. Some of you have on page 111. Some. Okay. How many of you don't have the book? If you are interested in having the books, they have extra books here. Okay, the extra books here, extra books. Come. Okay, then you are over there. Saradaraji?
Same problem.
Huh? Same problem. Okay. This is the stanza which we explain now. Which we explain now is on page 116 or page 111. Stanza 5, chapter 18, stanza 5, which reads, Ceasing of karmas and afflictions leads to nirvana. Karmas and afflictions arise from conceptual thought. These arise from mental elaboration, grasping into existence. Elaboration ceases by oriental emptiness. Okay, so this needs to explain a little bit, and you all know what the stanza is. But I'll explain this, you will realize that yes, I know this. See, ceasing of karmas and afflictions leads to nirvana. What's the opposite of nirvana?
Samsara.
So this is a suffering or samsara, number one. Now, samsara is because of the karmas, contaminated karmas. Precisely we have to say contaminated karmas. The karma there are two, contaminated karmas and uncontaminated karmas. This is the contaminated karmas. Then contaminated karmas are given rise to by afflictions. So, these three points are indicated by the first line. Ceasing of karmas and afflictions leads to nirvana, the opposites. Okay. Then the karmas and afflictions arise from conceptual thought. This conceptual thought here refers to the inappropriate attention, which is misperception of the characteristic of the object. In other words, false categorization of the object, or the misperception of the object, misperception of the characteristic of the object. This is referred to as conceptual thought. Technically, it is known as
inappropriate
attention. Okay, these here refers to the inappropriate attention. Inappropriate attention, in turn, arises from mental elaboration, grasping into existence. Mental elaboration refers to the ignorance, self-grasping ignorance. Mental elaboration here refers to the self-grasping ignorance. So with this we see that all the five points are intact. So if you don't want samsara or suffering, what should we do? We should cut the immediate cause. What's the immediate cause? Contaminant karmas. We have to stop the contaminant karmas. If you want to stop the contaminant karmas, what should you stop? Afflictions. If you want to stop the affliction, what should you stop? Inappropriate attention or the misperception of the characteristics of the object. If you want to stop the inappropriate attention, what should you do? You should stop the self-grasping ignorance. How to stop the self-grasping ignorance? The last line says, elaboration ceases by or into emptiness. So the self-grasping ignorance, elaboration of self-grasping ignorance will cease through the wisdom of emptiness. Okay, this is what we need to know. If you know this, now we go back to the page 62, the text which we are reading, page 62, which reads, all phenomena arise from causes. The causes are taught by the Tathagata. So what are the causes the Buddha, the Tathagata taught? These are the contaminant karmas, afflictions, inappropriate attention, and self-grasping ignorance. Okay, these are the four causes. Now, how to bring an end to these causes? Tell me. How to bring an end to these causes? How to stop these causes?
Wisdom of emptiness.
So it says, the cessation of the causes. Cessation meaning how to bring an end. Bringing an end to these causes as well is taught by the great seer. What was taught? The wisdom of emptiness is taught in order to stop the cause of the suffering. Very good. Okay. Then the text continues. Okay, for this, what I'd like to share with you here, which is very important. Okay, we have the sutra, we have the three principal parts. I don't know to what extent I can be successful in completing all these things within the next 2 hours. Not even 2 hours, one and a half hours.
Okay. So with this, what is takeaway for us, for you, for me, for all of us, is that, okay, suffering, I don't want suffering. If I don't want suffering, I have to stop the contaminated karmas. If I don't want contaminated karmas, I have to stop the
afflictions.
If I don't want afflictions, what should I do? I should stop the inappropriate attention. If I don't want inappropriate attention, what should I do? I should stop the self-grasping ignorance. Okay, I have to know how to stop these four things. I have to learn how to stop these four things. Okay, how to stop these four things? Theoretically, let's say that on the Arctic Circle, let's say there's an iceberg. Millions of years old iceberg. And on the iceberg, you build the houses. You build the houses. Now, because of global warming, icebergs melt. Although these icebergs have been lying there for the last millions and millions of years, but because of global warming, they are now melting. Once the icebergs melt, everything which is stacked on this, built on this, houses, all these things will crumble. You get me? Likewise, if you melt the iceberg of the self-grasping ignorance, which is a gram, self-grasping ignorance, then everything which is stacked on that, equal the offshoots of the self-grasping ignorance in the form of, what are the offshoots of the self-grasping ignorance? Inappropriate attention,
afflictions,
contaminants, they will all crumble. As they crumble, our suffering will crumble. Our suffering will become zero. This is the idea. This is the theory. Now practically, I'll give you one example. How many of you have seen ferocious waves on the ocean? Very ferocious waves. Just raise your hands. Who have seen the ferocious waves on the ocean? Okay, not much. Only the gentle waves. Okay, not the ferocious ones. Some of the ferocious ones are very scary. Very scary. You must see this thing. Then you, it will, huh? You can also, yes, of course. On the real, or as well as on television. Anybody seen the ferocious waves? Sakan, no, you have seen. Okay, real. Okay, Rahim?
I've seen.
Real or television?
In television.
Television? Yeah, okay. But real is very scary. Particularly when you are close by, it's extremely scary. Okay, so look, see your job, what you would like to do is that you want to see the very clear water of the ocean. And unfortunately what was happening was that there was a very ferocious waves on the surface. Ferocious waves, that the metaphor for the contaminated karmas, negative karmas, right? Negative karmas. But the ferocious waves are there. Can you imagine that you can see the very clear water? Why not? Ferocious waves, they have the color of the white, whitish color, right? The clarity is not visible. Okay, if you want to see the clarity of the water, first the ferocious waves must be brought to calmness. You agree with me? If you really want to get with the self-grasping ignorance, the subtlest version of the mental defilements, first we must stop the very ferocious waves like negative karmas. We must stop them, negative karmas. Like what? 10 non-virtuous negative karmas, 10 non-virtuous karmas. We must try best to stay away from these 10 non-virtuous karmas. 3 physical, 4 verbal, and 3 mental. We must try our best to stay away. It doesn't mean that we learn it today and tomorrow we become perfectly pure. No, let's not expect that. But try our best to stay away from the 10 non-virtuous actions. It's not easy. If it's this easy, then overnight you can change. Then everybody should become Buddha by now. Nobody's suffering now. But it's not reality. It's not easy. So we have to get rid of the 10 non-religious karmas. What are they? 3 physical, 4 verbal,
Loki.
And 3 mental. You getting it? Okay, 3 physical. What are 3 physical?
No killing, no stealing.
No killing, no stealing, no sexual misconduct. No killing, no stealing, no sexual misconduct. Okay, let's say no killing. No killing, okay, killing animals, killing human beings, to killing animals, to killing insects, and so forth. It's more direct. Indirectly, going to like non-vegetarian food and so forth. Okay, so first let's say, the killing, human beings, animals, the big animals, that you know, will not do. That for sure will not do, right? And then the mosquitoes, and the termites, then the cockroaches. These are the main problem, right? Okay, practically speaking, keep in mind that finally, whatever practice that you're doing for your own good, it's not for the Buddha, it's not for Buddhism, not for anybody else, for your own good. For your own good, see that all your thought process must be grounded on compassion. Must be grounded on compassion, skillful compassion. Not just compassion, skillful compassion. Where? Skillful compassion means where you display compassion. At the same time, people cannot take advantage of your compassion. Oftentimes, when you're compassionate, people take advantage of your compassion. So, where you can display compassion, at the same time people cannot take advantage of that, your compassion is known as skillful compassion. So the ground must be compassion, skillful compassion. With this in mind, see that, say the mosquitoes. Mosquitoes can have a pretty problematic, like what is the malaria and chikungunya, what is that?
Dengue.
What's the problem there? For that matter, in your house, instead of the mosquitoes there, and then you just kill them rashly. No, never ever do that. Never ever do that. See how you can, first try to avoid, try to somehow not let the mosquitoes to come in, right? Before they come in, so whatever things to be done, like all the mosquito coil, or the all out, knockout, whatever, you know, you put that before the mosquitoes, they come. And then the windows, and in your room, for example, the windows with mesh. All these things are extremely important. Particularly if it is your own house, make sure that the windows, they are, you know, the meshed. Is very important. And then otherwise, if it's not your house, then see, you know, how it's not my house, is the Tibet house, so I cannot really change everything like this. I put something like a mesh, and if it's skillful, maybe, you know, somebody help me to do that. That's very helpful. One, the idea is that stay away from killing, even including the mosquitoes. One. Then number two, the cockroaches is again a problem. Cockroach, how do you deal with the cockroaches? So for that, what happened was that this is my personal experience, and many people, they, you know, ask me. In fact, they ask me for what? So that, okay, you exempted. They want this answer. Right? And luckily, after my personal experience. So therefore, you know, you will not get this exemption. So, they said that, okay, Shala, what do you do? There are so many cockroaches, and practically, it's, you know, there are thousands of them are there in the kitchen. What do you do? I have a personal experience. What happened was that, you know, Zamba, what is Zamba? You don't know what is Zamba? How do you explain this?
Body powder.
Zamba, what is Zamba?
Body powder.
Okay. Ready-made, the grounded body, the powder, or the cooked, pre-cooked. So you can, you know, eat it directly. And people come to give me that. This is the Tibetan staple food. People come to give me that. And then in my house, in other places, very convenient. In other places, in Delhi, it's very complicated.
you don't see the cows around. Whereas if you see the cows really readily available, then you can go to give them, you know, you mix them with water, they will be very happy. But then they will find it very difficult. So therefore they're stacked in my house. And then some of my relatives, they come, this is not nice. They then put it so nicely inside the interior of the kapat. Interior kapat, not visible, and then the kitchen looks so nice. Then I have no clue what. Then after about 1 or 2 months, then I could see that 1 or 2 cockroaches coming out. Where is this coming from? Where is this coming from? No clue. Where is this coming from? Usually I don't have cockroaches. Where is it coming from? From the earlier, from the window, kitchen, all these rows of kitchens are there. What is that? Door flat. All these are the same row from the cockroaches from other day migrate to my house. So they wipe the mesh. No, there's no. How come that the cockroaches come here? Then one day, to take up one utensil, I opened the cupboard. Hundreds are there because my, the relatives who came there to clean up my kitchen, they put all these eatables inside the interior of the cupboard, which I didn't know that they were there. And then from there, the cockroaches started breeding. Hundreds were there, hundreds. So I took out everything from inside, the food. Cockroaches, let them stay there. And I kept little food there. Because they would die hungry. So that I can bring food there. The rest I took out so that they cannot breed more. The rest I took out, I dumped. And then gradually the breeding stopped. Breeding stopped. And then otherwise on the shelf, everything clean. And then the food also. Food also, they ate it then because the food is less, automatically the number also reduces. And it becomes very clean. Right? Don't expect to clean them up in one day. In one day, how to remove them? Which means that you are some form, waste means to kill. This is not advisable. You should be a little patient. It may take another few weeks or 1 month that gradually they will disappear. Okay. The thing is that we have to take precaution to keep things clean and the eatables will not, kept exposed. Okay. So this is how we can help. And the termites. The termites are the termites, the doors, same. Termites is actually relatively is easier. You can change the door. And even the door with the termite, don't just put it to fire directly. Keep them separately for some time, and then automatically, they will somehow disappear. Yeah, which means they will eat up the door. Which means little patient. Okay, no killing. Then number two, okay, and then related to this, vegetarianism. And I personally, I don't ever tell people that you should become vegetarian. This is not what I see as wise. So what I suggest, I'm vegetarian. One time, okay, it's very long, I have many things to cover. Basically, vegetarianism, I suggest that, see what steps you can take. It's not necessary that on health ground, health is very important, extremely important. On health ground, if there's no way other than to take non-veg, continue, don't force yourself. And some of us, the vegetarians, they are so activists, extreme activists. As well like the non-veg people, they are like demons. They make the non-veg people as they do like they're demons. That's too much. We should be very skillful. We should be very realistic. So the idea is that the non-veg people see what steps to take. There are number of options. It's not necessary that today you hear about vegetarianism, tomorrow you become vegetarian. No, it's not necessary. Be very realistic. What step that you can take? See that you take that step. Say for example, some of you may say, it's not a problem. From tomorrow I will change to vegetarian complete. That's fine, so good. And some of you, okay, no, that I cannot do. Instead, many people, what they do is that okay, I stopped cooking meat in my own house. When I go out, I eat. But inside my house, I keep it very clean. I don't cook any meat. This is one option. It's amazing. At this person is taking a step. And some people, they say that, okay, from 2 hours, I stop eating the chicken and I stop eating the fish. And you know, the others, I continue to eat. Because again, a person is taking a step. It's so good. And some people say that on the auspicious days, on the sacred days, like the 25th, the 10th, 30th, or 15th, on these, or the lunar calendar, on these days, I refrain from eating meat. That's not again amazing steps. We have to appreciate people taking steps. And then some people, they say that, okay, the once in a month, I stay away from chicken meat. Or let's say, the once in a week, I stay away from chicken meat. Or I take meat only once in a week, once in a month. Amazing steps taken. And if nothing works, some people say that at least I really appreciate the people who are vegetarian. I really appreciate them. Okay, although I cannot do anything myself, but I really appreciate these people. This is also amazing. It's so good. It's not that everybody should be today learn of vegetarianism, the next day you become vegetarian. No, it's not necessary. We should be very realistic. And particularly if you have health issues, where some people have the B12 problem, that would be a problem, and then the protein and the many other factors. Not only the B12, in B12 we have supplements there, and protein also we have supplements. But the point is that where we, some people, even with the supplements, it doesn't really help. The body doesn't digest these supplements. So then exception. Okay, this is not killing. The next one is no stealing. Okay, no stealing. Going there to steal things will not happen. Okay, whereas I said using the objects which do not belong to you. We may casually do that. Using objects possessed by the group, possessed by the company, possessed by the association, possessed by, for example, say, Choe Center, and possessed by the government, and you use it for your private benefit. So this, always stay away from that. And for example, let's say that, okay, Choe Ling, and let's say that they have this cup there, and then you are in urgent need of a cup, just for urgent need of a cup, and then you have been supporting Choe Ling so much, and then you see that there's a Choe Ling glass there. And you can take, okay, I'll use this and I'll replace with a better one. Or I'll replace with 2 for Choe Ling. That's fine. That's not out of stealing with the intention to deprive the institution for your selfish interest. It's because of urgency. These nuances are there. Otherwise, the point is that with the selfish interest, not to use your possessions instead of somebody else's possession, this is stealing. So that we just stop. Killing, stealing. And the other 3 is sexual misconduct. For sexual misconduct, the best is what you find in the first volume of Lama's Longest Book. The 3 volumes, Labyrinth, 3 volumes. But from the first volume, you will see the details of all the 10 non-vicious actions and the sexual misconduct. You read from there, it's very important. You have to read that. Okay, 3 physical. And then the 4 verbal. What 4 verbal?
Green lights. Green lights.
Telling lies. Just saying. Even out of zest, even out of, say, joke, stay away from telling lies. Try your best. Including me. Try your best. Even for joke, to tell lies. Just stay away from that. Do the best you can. And then for purpose, for a greater purpose, for example, like one example which is commonly given, is that if there is, let's say, a robber chasing somebody, and you are lying here, and the person, the victim, ran from your right side, and the robber asks, where is this person? And then if you give the direction, right direction, then the victim will be killed or the something. So in which case, then you may say that, yeah, the victim went through this direction, like this, the victim will be saved. Victim meaning somebody, you know, the robber is going to accumulate negative karma otherwise, and the victim is going to suffer great pain otherwise, to stop them. And these options are there. Otherwise, besides these greater purposes, stay away from 10 lives. Okay, what's next?
Harsh words.
Harsh words. Harsh words? Okay. Harsh words, the tendency is that in most cases, the likelihood is the harsh words towards your parents, and particularly the mothers. This is most likely. So there we should be extremely careful to make sure that we stay away from using harsh words towards your parents. This is so important. And then the harsh words, husband towards the wife, and wife towards the husband, right? It's also another likelihood. And where the husband-wife harsh words happen, then the tendency is fight. Harsh words from the children towards the mothers, particularly towards mothers, is not really the cause of a fight, but the mother suffers terribly. Now, in this world, the parents, they've already now become a little old, and then, now physically, they're becoming a little, not as competent, and then the only hope for love and affection is from the children, and the children, these just scares the parents. This is terrible. This is too much. So the children, you love your parents, no doubt, but make sure that the parents feel that love and affection. How to do that? You don't do anything. You don't do anything. Just stop using harsh words. This is a miracle. The parents will feel the glow. They'll feel the glow. In fact, in one place, in Vietnam, where I recently went, and in a big hospital, the parents started the hospital, and the son was now taking over their parents' responsibility. Son is a very competent person, gentleman. And then the son, the father, and three of us we met, and then I was telling the son that, okay, when the child is very competent, taking the charge of the parents now, taking the responsibility of the parents now, the tendency is that the children, the child, may, deep inside you love your parent, you love your parents, but because now that you are having a huge responsibility, then your expression of love towards your parents may go down. You may not, if you don't keep that in mind, the importance of that, the tendency that you not expressing love and affection towards your parents can likely happen, particularly the sons. The daughters is much better, but the daughters, they can use harsh words. Harsh words, this is totally unnecessary. And where's the son? And then I told the boy, the son, that your parents do not want anything from you. Do not want anything from you. They only want one thing from you. That is your continuous love and affection. This is what they want. They don't want anything from you otherwise. Then I shared one story. It's a real story. And for today, for this class, what I would say is that more than the completing the text, three principal parts, so forth, is we have to know these realities. Then in a day-to-day life, you're dealing with your parents will improve, and then you'll start accumulating negative karmas. And then you'll be benefited. And not only you'll be benefited in the long run, you'll be benefited, immediately you'll be benefited. Okay, so what happened was that in Taiwan, there was a father and a daughter. Father and daughter. And the daughter migrated to America. And every year the daughter comes to meet the father for a holiday, maybe for about 1 month. And the daughter takes for granted, oh, he's my father, what present should I, you know, what gift should I take? He's my father. So she never takes gifts.
But then she, as she grows older, she realized that her, the friends, other girls, when they go to meet their parents, they always take some gifts. Then she started to feel a little odd. And then one time, she was thought, okay, this time I will take some gifts. Again, she forgot. She already came home. Already. She forgot. What do you do now? And then what she did was that she prepared an envelope and she put $300 in it and gave it to the father. This is my gift for you. And the father, you could not believe. The father, just seeing this envelope, father just treasured it. He was so happy. Okay. If I stop it there, you may think that the father is, you know, he's so fond of dollars. You may think like this. Okay, to complete the story. Then the girl already stayed there for 1 month. And it was for the girl to go back to America. And the father gave the girl $7,000. You're getting it? So for the father, $300 is nothing. It was not that he likes the girl. Because this reflects the daughter's love and affection. That is what he was treasuring. Because he could feel the daughter's, he did not want anything. He simply wanted the love and affection from the daughter. This was for the first time reflected from this envelope with $300. So he really cherished it. And to make the daughter happy, she gave $7,000. You getting it? So the parents, they don't really, okay, generally speaking, the parents don't really expect anything from you. What they love is they want your love and affection. So be it the young ones like Sanika, and for all of you, most of us here, I'm sure that you have your own parents still alive. You're very lucky to have your parents alive. So why not we take the maximum advantage to make them happy now? It's so, make them happy. You don't want to do anything, just make them happy. How to make them happy? And to make them happy, okay, I love you, don't say this, you don't have to say this. Just stop shouting at your parents. Unnecessarily shouting, just stop them. This is good enough, the parents, and then say, the parents, you come home, and the parents, may, your mother, the old mother, may say, oh, my son, you like a cup of tea. Yeah, not at all appreciative of the mothers. Instead, you're already grown up. Why should you have to wait for the old mother to come to serve you? Your father to come to serve you? Tell him, Mom, please take rest. I'll serve you. What do you like to have? Right? The mother will be so happy. The father will be so happy. This is what they do not expect. Now this is what they are seeing in you, the transformation. Then there's a glow coming in your parents' face. You wouldn't believe there's a glow coming in your parents' face. Just do this much. It's good enough to make your parents happy. This is so important. Because of this, because you see the glow in your parents' face, deep inside you love your parents. Because of that, the love that you feel towards your parents, because now you have become more self-sufficient, this is an effect. As you become more and more self-sufficient, and you become more engrossed in other responsibilities with your wife, with your husband, with you, and your new child, newborn child, and your job, so forth. And then the relationship with the parents become more and more distant, and the love that you feel towards your parents, they become more and deeper and deeper down. So when you stop shouting, and you instead of the parents serving you, you start serving the parents, then the glow comes to your parents' face, then you will see the glory in the parents' face, this love that you feel towards the parents, which has been going down, they will come to the surface. Then the parents will see the glow in your face. Amazing, beautiful. Look at this child, like age 4 or 5, coming from school, craving to see the parents. And they see the parents, they jump in the laps of the parents. And the parents have a special glow in the face. Look at this relationship. This will come back to you, even when you are in your 20s, 30s, 40s. This relationship will come back to you when you start treating your parents slightly differently. This is what we have to do. Okay, harsh words. So see how to stay away from harsh words. And then likewise, husband to wife, wife to husband. Very important. Because the tendency of the for the husband and wife, that they can easily, you know, for small reasons they fight. It can easily happen. So that we should be more matured. We should be more matured. Don't ever think of, you know, fighting with trivialities. Fight means to use harsh words. You say that if the wife tells you something, you say that, how dare you say like this? No, I did not say. Yes, you said it. Right? And you said, no, I didn't say that. Yes, you said it. And then the both volume increases. Right? Just for what? For a very small thing. I've seen this with my own eyes. It's just totally unnecessary. We can stop all these unnecessary things and see that your family is a much happier family. If the two parents, they're very friendly, they stop all the unnecessary fights. Children, they love you both. They don't want to see the two parents split. And these fights, they are the basis for the splits of the parents. So that it's so important to the parents, make sure that for the child, you just trap the arguments. This is so important. Okay. No harsh words. Then what next?
Divisive speech.
Divisive speech. Divisive speech or the slander? Slander or divisive speech? So two people are friendly, and then you deliberately, because you don't like person A, you deliberately split person A and B. This is extremely negative karma. Extremely very strong negative karma. So the two people, even if you disagree with person A, if the person A and B, they are going along so well, why should you split? Give them as they are. But if you split, you are accumulating negative karma, whereby in future lifetimes, you will never have reliable friends. You will never have reliable friends and reliable partners. This is the negative karma that we accumulate. Okay, then what next?
Idle gossip
per se is not a negative, is not a heavy negative karma, but it's a very, it becomes heavy negative karma because of the, it is very likely to happen very easily, because of which it's a cumulative, because the cumulative effect, it can become huge, idle gossip. And idle gossip, the tendency is that when the same three people meet, first we start with the nice talk, and then it will become more and more dilute, more and more, and then become pure idle gossip, commenting on somebody else, oh, this girl has been changing clothes 3 times a day, it's not your business, right, oh, he has this, what is the Omega Watch, I'm like, this is not a job, right? Just take care of your own emotions. You have no time to, you know, to poke your nose in others' business. So idle gossip unnecessarily triggers many other negative karmas. Okay, so no idle gossip. Okay, so these are the four verbal, and then three mental. What are three mental? Covetousness, ill will, and wrong view. Covetousness. Covetousness is the greed. Greed over the possession of others. Greed over the possessions of others. This is one of the major the negative karmas. Say, for example, you go to a shop. You go to a shop, okay, you see good things there. What are the clothes? Branded clothes? Levi's, what is that?
Levi's.
And what are the grandparents are there?
Zara,
Levi's. You see this, okay, that's good, I like to have it. This is not really covetousness. You getting it? This is a greed, attachment. This is not really covetousness. Covetousness is a very serious matter. This attachment, it is not good, It is not good. You want it, it's not a problem. But unrealistically you want it, this is attachment. Whereas the covetousness is very different. Covetousness is the desire, greed of the objects, things, which somebody else already possessed. Because that is the cause of all the fights and the wars and the litigation cases. Nowadays, litigation cases, right? For example, the relationships. Already, you know, somebody in marital state there, and then you act in, you know, engages involved in somebody else's extramarital affairs. All these things fall under the category of the covetousness. These can have a tremendous the repercussions, because whole community becomes disharmonious, will destabilize the whole community, whole family, and it is such a big pain on the others. And then, for example, if somebody else has a nice thing, yeah, and then the covetousness arises, and then you think of stealing this, or say, for example, the covetousness happens on the various levels, family level, community level, on the international level as well, national level, international level. National level, for example, there was the war happening between Karnataka and what? For the water. Over the water, what is that? It's a form of covetousness, you know, we should deal with this issue nicely. And for example, the nations, they try to conquer each other. It's pure covetousness. Right? For example, Russia trying to conquer Crimea. Right? And Ukraine, Crimea.
Or China to over Tibet.
And China to over Tibet. It's purely covetousness. And because of this look, for example, so because of this, China always face it, you know, they cover his face. Because of this, if this is not, look, they're so keen on expansionism. Everywhere you get the problems are created, everywhere. Japan, Philippines, Bhutan, the India, the Ladakh. Everywhere Japan, everywhere creating problem is simply because of the covetousness, the belief in expansionism. What is expansionism? Covetousness. Covetousness. So covetousness can create all these problems in the family, in the community, on the national level, on the international level. Okay, covetousness. Then ill will. Ill will is the wanting to harm others. Disliking others is one. Disliking others is fine. Okay, I don't really like this person. That's, of course, this is not good. This is not good. It's the negative. Negative, but then ill will, wanting to harm others. That is worse. This really destroys your virtue. It destroys virtue so much. And this, again, another great factor for the disharmony in the community. And not only disharmony, really, what do you call it? The corrosive feelings, cold wars. Were all happening because of this, and in individual, there's such a the corrosion happening within your mind. At the moment you feel this, the ill will, the malice, our immune system will go down directly. You lose your immune system. With the immune system gone, you can easily contract all forms of illnesses, and your lifespan will be shortened. Longevity, you have to sacrifice the longevity. Okay, these are, and then the wrong view. Wrong view is disbelieving in the efficacy of the law of karma. Disbelieving in the efficacy of law of karma. That you could do good things, good things will happen. Whether in this life, next life, wherever. Do bad things will happen to you. Right? Disbelieving in this efficacy of law of karma, this is the wrong view. Okay, we'll stop here for tea break.